Okay, good afternoon, everybody. This is Mass 465. And then this week we have the homework 2, 3, and 2, 4 due Friday. And then you did the midterm, and then the result was average 192 out of 300, so 64%, and the highest is 261. And I posted just the answer, simple answers on the Blackboard. And then they have questions about the midterm. If you have, then I can show you the solution in detail. Do you have any question about the midterm? No question? If not, then I don't say anything, but if you have kind of private question, then you can email me, because I can't show you the graded paper to you. I didn't write anything on the paper. Just I looked at and then I graded. So anyway, if you have questions on the midterm privately, and then you can ask me, you can email me. Okay, then what about the homework question 2.3 and 2.4? Do you have any question about the homework? Do you have any question? Really? No question? Okay. Then we go on to a new section. I skip two sections, 2.5. 2.5 is a hypergeometric distribution, and then 2.6 is a negative binomial distribution. I skip those two. And go on to Poisson distribution. So 2.7. Poisson distribution. Poisson is a French mathematician, 19th century mathematician. Full name is Simeon Denis Poisson. Simeon Denis Poisson. 1781, okay, and then 1840. So 59, he died. Okay. 19th century mathematician. I know his name, just the Poisson distribution. Okay. I don't know any other part, any other field. So he contributed to probability theory, maybe. But in those days, any mathematician did every field of mathematics, because there were not so many fields. Like probably he did number theory, geometry, and then probability theory, and so on. Okay. Maybe analysis, calculus, analysis. So he did everything, probably. But Poisson distribution is the famous one. Okay. So here's the definition of the Poisson distribution. Poisson distribution. And then this text is taken this step. An approximate Poisson process. What? Okay. X, random variable X is subject to an approximate Poisson process. Approximate Poisson process. What is the process? I don't know why the authors are using this process. Approximate random variable, then I can understand, but why a process? I don't understand. Approximate Poisson distribution, then I understand, not process. But it's okay, yeah, because authors are using this. And then this has a parameter, lambda. Like binomial distribution, we have two parameters, N and P. N and the number of trials, and then P is the probability of success. And then in this case, we have only one parameter with parameter lambda. Okay. This is a parameter. And then you will see that if this lambda is given, then average of the random variable is lambda, and also lambda is a variance of the random variable x. Very weird random variable. The average and the variance, they are same. Okay. Lambda. So here we have a definition. There are three conditions. X is on AB, okay, interval AB. Okay. X on the interval CD. Oh yeah, that's why we need a process, the word process. The process is a kind of time series. Time series means at time A, it's some random variable. At time A and a half, it's going to be another random variable. So on this interval, for each point here, and X becomes a random variable. So X is dependent on the number in this interval. Okay. And then these two intervals are disjoint. Okay. There's no common point. So intersection is empty. Then the assumption is, okay, these two are independent. Okay. Two random variables and independent, we have defined by the we have defined two events independent when the probability of the intersection of those two events is the product of the probability of each one. And then likewise, we can determine X on this interval and an X on this interval, they are independent because by the way that event that X takes some value on this interval, and then X takes some value on this interval, if they are disjoint like this, then they are independent. Okay. So that's a way we define the independence of two random variables, or maybe more precisely, okay, precisely. X on this interval is say written as X1, okay? And X on this interval is say X2, okay? Then the probability that X1 is equal to some number, say X1, okay? And then also X2 is equal to X2, some number. We consider the probability of this event. This happens and this happens. And that's gonna be equal to the random variable X1 takes the X1 and times the random variable X2 takes the body X2. Okay. But this is true for any X1, X2. Okay, so that's Independence. Independence means this. Okay. This intersection was this. That probability is a product of those two. So that's what this means. I'm writing x1 as the random variable on this interval, x2 as the random variable x on this interval. And then consider the probability of this. The probability of this is the product of each probability, this times this. So that's what this means. If you don't see it clearly, then that's okay. That okay means that we don't have to be so precise. We don't have to be so precise. And then sometimes the author is not explaining clearly. Sometimes I'm confused. Sometimes. But still we can understand. So don't worry. Part B is the probability that X takes some values. Okay, this X is taking numbers. Okay, the values that X takes are 0, 1, 2, 3, okay, up to infinity. Okay, those are not four dots, but yeah. Those are the values that X can take. X takes non-negative integers. That's an assumption. Okay, I didn't mention, but this is an assumption. X takes the values 0, 1, 2, 3, dot, 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 up to infinity. And then X takes the value, say, 1. Okay? X can take 1 on an interval of length h. On an interval of lengths h. Lengths h. We can consider this probability. X is equal to 1 on some interval of length h. Okay. And this is approximately equal to, now we're going to use this lambda. Okay, that is lambda h. Not equal, but approximately. This is approximately equal to lambda h. This is the assumption. So that's why we are calling approximate Poisson process. Exact Poisson process, this is equal to. This is equal to. Well, anyway, x can take any non-negative integers, okay, 0, 1, 2, up to infinity. And then if x is equal to 1 on some interval of length h, then that probability is approximately lambda times h. And this is an assumption. And then one more condition is, of course, we can consider the probability that x is taking the values greater than or equal to 2. Okay, greater than or equal to 2. In a sufficiently short interval, in sufficiently, this part is ambiguous, I know. Sufficiently short subinterval, subinterval. Then this is almost zero, okay? Approximately zero. This is the condition. And when you study, well, next step is studying 565, I guess, okay, statistics. Some of you are going to take 565. And you will see, okay, what the statistics is about. And then statistics is very approximate, not exact. Theories are exact, but we can deal with the numbers, and then that is a kind of approximate. So you will see, not exact like abstract algebra or analysis, but statistics is a little bit more approximate. I'm not saying that is ambiguous or bad. I don't say that, but statistic is using approximation very frequently. And that's the idea of statistics. So anyway, Poisson process is defined in this way, okay, first of all. Approximate Poisson process. But still we can derive some result. Okay, so consider x is the number of occurrences in an interval of length 1. Okay. This is a number of, something occurs, so now that occurrence is 0, no occurrence, so 1 occurrence or 2 occurrences and so on. Okay, so this is indicating something happened in some interval. Okay, this interval or in this interval. Okay, so the number of occurrences in an interval of length 1. Okay, interval of length 1. We consider length h here, length h, then that's going to be equal to approximately equal to lambda h. X is equal to 1 on the interval of length h, that's going to be lambda h. And this is what we assume. And now we are sorry about the noise. This is a Monday special.
Okay.
So, in a minute or so, yeah, he's gone. He'll be gone. So. X is the number of occurrences in an interval of length 1. Then we like to consider the probability that X is equal to X. Okay. This is what? This is what? This is for x is equal to 0, 1, 2, and dot, dot, dot. So we like to consider the probability that x is equal to x. We like to find this guy. Okay. Then what happens is we have to take a limit, and then we can precisely express this probability using lambda, using lambda. So here's the solution. Okay. So unit interval is given. Like 0, 1 interval, length is 1. Then we can partition this interval into n sub-intervals. So partition into n sub-intervals. Then our length is, of course, 1 over n of lengths. 1 over n. This is that length. Okay, if you partition this way, then we can consider the event that x is equal to x. This event can be expressed as x is equal to x. This is the event. And this event can be expressed as, okay, this happens here. What? One occurrence in each of exactly x of these n subintervals. One occurrence. One occurrence in each of exactly x sub intervals, x of these n sub intervals. This is what we can say. So yeah, visually this is the interval, okay, length is 1. So we can take then say 0 to 1, okay, 0 to 1. So we partition this guy into some number of sub-intervals like this, okay. We can go on, of course, okay, more, do you like more? Okay. This is the one we have. So n sub-intervals. Then we can pick this interval, and this interval, or there are x intervals, sub-intervals. And then on each sub-interval, then there's one occurrence. In this sub-interval, one occurrence, this interval, one occurrence, and so on. So total of x sub-intervals. That's what this is saying. Okay, now what? All right, now. We have to use the assumptions. There are three assumptions, A, B, and C. Okay, then we can move on. Okay, we can move on to the next step. Now, probability of one occurrence in any one subinterval. One occurrence. And in any one subinterval, okay. What do you think? We have to use this assumption, part B. Okay, you can't see this, but these are probably that x is equal to 1 on an interval of length h is approximately lambda times h. Now this h is 1 over n, so this is approximately lambda times 1 over n, is that right? This is our h, interval length, so this is approximately equal to lambda times 1 over h, and this is given, this is by the assumption part B, okay, by part B, you can say this. Anything else? This is one occurrence. Okay. Then what about two? Two or more. Okay. Two or more occurrence. This is approximately equal to zero. Okay. This is by the assumption C, I think. Yes, assumption C. Okay, this is these are the ones we can say. Two or more will not appear. Well, approximately probability zero. So that's what we say. So we're using the assumptions part B and part C. Okay? Then, can you calculate the probability that x is equal to x? Can you calculate this guy? We can ignore two or more, okay, two or more part. Then we have to consider this one occurrence in any. This is the one we have to use. So now here, one more time, x is equal to x is one occurrence in each of exactly x of these n subintervals. So first of all, we have to pick x subintervals from n subintervals. Is that right? We have to pick x subintervals from n subintervals. How many such ways? Out of n, we have to choose x subintervals. N choose x. Okay, this many. Once you have picked x subintervals, then in each interval, okay, each subinterval, the occurrence of one occurrence in any subinterval is equal to lambda over n. Okay? This must happen. Lambda over n. And then this will happen how many times? We have x sub interval, so this to the power x, right? This must be the case. And what else? And on other intervals, okay, other intervals, okay, when it happens, so 1 minus lambda over n, right? This is success, okay, probability of success. This is probability of failure. Okay. This must happen how many times? Out of n, we have picked x, so left over is n minus x. Okay, this must happen. And then this is the number of ways to pick x subintervals from n subintervals. So this guy is very close to this guy, probability of x is equal to x. So we can say this. So this is an important approximation. This is an important one. And based on this, we can figure out the define the Poisson distribution by what? Okay, by here we have n. N is here. We divided, well, we made a partition of the interval, unit interval, into n subintervals. And what happens if this n is going to infinity? Okay. So as n goes to infinity, okay, this is a question we're interested in. This will go to what as n goes to infinity? Okay. So we'd like to take the limit of this stuff. Okay. And then n is going to infinity. So now what happens? Let's see. Okay. That's an interesting part. We like to take the limit. And a calculus is involved, of course. Yeah. So now we take the limit of this stuff. Limit of n goes to infinity. And then n choose x. And then lambda over n to the power x, and then 1 minus lambda over n to the power n minus x. And this is what we are talking about. Limit n goes to infinity, okay? What is n choose n? N choose x. N choose x is this guy. N choose x is a, of course, n factorial divided by x factorial times n minus x factorial. And I simplify n factorial divided by n minus x factorial. So that's going to be n minus 1, and so on. And then last one would be n minus x plus 1. And this is a numerator. And divided by x factorial, that's going to be the n choose x. So I'm going to write x factorial over here. Okay. This fraction is n choose x. Do you see? Yeah, please see. Okay. Otherwise, we can't move on. Next step here, n to the power x. N to the power x is here. Okay. I'm going to write n to the power x here. N to the power x. N to the power x is in the bottom, the denominator. And lambda to the x is here, lambda to the x. I'm going to write lambda to the x over here. Okay. So we have taken care of those two factors, okay? Those two factors. And last factor, I'm going to write this as, okay, 1 minus lambda over n to the power n. It is n minus x, so I took n. And the negative x is coming here. It times 1 minus lambda over n to the negative x. How's this? Make sense? This doesn't have n. Okay, so this is a constant. It is a constant. N is not there, so this is a constant. We can't touch this. Also, this guy has n here, and n here, and n here, and n everywhere. And then take care of these guys. Okay? Then I want to ask you, how many factors over here? Can you tell me how many factors over here? 1, 2, 3, up to how many factors over here?
N minus X.
N minus X. Really? When X is equal to 1, then this is just 1. Okay. X is equal to 2, then what? This is N minus 1. So two factors. X is equal to 2, then two factors. How many factors? X factors. Okay. X factors. You see? There are N factor, X factors. 1, 2, 3, after X factors. This has X factors too. N times, N times, N times, N. This is N times, N times, dot, N. X factors. This has X factors. This has X factors. Then, what is the limit when X goes to infinity? X is a fixed number. Okay, X is a fixed number. And then this has a N to the X. In the numerator, N to the X is here. Denominator, N to the X. This is the largest degree term, N to the X. Next one is a something times N to the X minus 1, and so on. These are the main factors. N to the X, N to the X here. So when N goes to infinity, then this is, what is the limit of this guy? This goes to 1, okay, 1. Whatever X is, okay, N goes to infinity, then this is going to 1. Good. What about this part? What do you think? When N goes to infinity, this is going to, when N goes to infinity, this is going to 0, right? That means this goes to 1 minus lambda over N goes to 1. 1 to the negative X, so this goes to 1, okay, 1. N goes to infinity, this goes to 0. So necessarily this part goes to 1. So 1 to the negative X is 1. Okay. Now thing is here, this guy. What do you think? Right, so what we have is that this is going to 1 and this is a constant. So we only have this is going to 1. This is a constant, lambda to the x, and then x factorial. And what we need is this, okay? 1 plus negative lambda over n to the power n, n times this is going to 1. So consider this part. What is this limit? Do you know this? What is this limit? What is the definition of V? E is a limit of 1 plus 1 over n to the power n, right? E is a limit of this guy. And then depressed by, say, t. What do you think? This is e to the t, okay? This is the one we like to use, and this is a formula, okay? E to the t is limit of 1 plus t over n to the power n. T is a constant. This limit is e to the t. So this is your t now. Negative lambda is your t. So this is going to e to the negative lambda. Okay. So this is our conclusion. So limit is given by lambda to the x times e to the negative lambda over x factorial. Okay, this is a limit. One more time. Okay, this is defined to be. Okay, this is a definition. Defined to be the probability that x is equal to x. This is our definition. And we can write this as small f of x, probability mass function. Okay. Probability mass function of x. This is our definition, all right? This is obtained. And then now this will define the Poisson distillation. Okay. You have to memorize this. The probability mass function is lambda to the x times e to the negative lambda divided by x factorial. And this x is from 0, 1, 2 up to infinity. Okay. X is equal to 0, 1, 2 up to infinity. Non-negative integer valued random variable. That is called the Poisson. That is subject to the Poisson distribution. Yeah. The probability mass function is given by lambda to the x times e to the negative lambda and then x factorial. Okay. And so we're going to write this as, yes, so write this as x is subject to the Poisson distribution. Okay, Poisson. And the parameter is lambda, only one parameter, lambda. As we will see, the mean is lambda, and then variance is lambda also. Very weird distribution. That's what we denote. So this is our notation, okay? We have defined the Poisson distribution, okay? So this is called the Poisson distribution. Poisson distribution. You have questions so far? The important idea is this, okay, this idea, this limit, limit of 1 plus t over n to the power n is e to the t. Okay. This is one of the definitions of e. Number e is defined probably, first of all, by this, by Euler, I guess. And then the second one is an infinite series. And also there's another one, third one, considering the area of the region under the curve of y is equal to 1 over x. So there are three definitions for E. Maybe there's another one. I don't know. I just don't know. There are three, at least three. I knew. I know. I don't know other. Right, then next step is I would like to get the mean and the variance for this guy. And to get this, we consider the moment generating function for x, moment generating function, right? So here's the process. To get the mean and the variance, we derive the moment generating function. Okay. And x is Poisson. Okay, Poisson. And then get the moment generating function, m of t. Okay, how do you get this guy? What is this moment generating function? This is by definition. Always starting from the definition. Okay, so in doing mathematics, definition is the most important part. If you forgot the definition, then you can't do it. Okay. Memorize anything. Definition, theorem, whatever. Then that's your power, as I mentioned. Okay. This is the definition. Yes? All right. Then this is how to get this guy. This is a function e to the tx, so we have e to the tx, right? And then x is equal to 0, 1, 2 up to infinity, so x is equal to 0 to infinity. This is a sum, and times the mass function, the mass function is this, lambda to the x divided by, times e to the negative lambda, okay, divided by x factorial. Okay, this is that one. So we have to simplify this. We have no choice but simplify. How do you simplify this? We have x factorial, and then e to the negative lambda, this is a constant, okay? Not depending on x, this is a constant. So take care of these two factors. lambda to the x, this is e to the t to the power x. This is e to the tx is e to the t to the power x. So we can write this guy as, okay, first of all, e to the negative lambda goes outside of the sigma, e to the negative lambda goes outside. And then we combine these two as e to the t times lambda to the x. So this is lambda times e to the t to the power x. There we go. This portion. Okay, this portion is e lambda times e to the t to the power x. Because lambda to the x, lambda to the x, e to the t to the power x is e to the tx. And this is divided by x factorial. All right, x is equal to 0 to infinity. What's next? What is this sum? We have a formula. Okay? What is the formula? T to the x divided by x factorial. X is equal to 0 to infinity. What is this sum? T to the x, t is a variable, okay? X is a kind of n, okay? N is equal to 0 to infinity. What is this sum? Please tell me. T to the x, and then divided by x factorial, and the sum to 0 through infinity. This is e to the t exponential function. There's a power series representation of exponential function e to the t. So now we have x factorial here. Instead of t, we have lambda times e to the t. Okay, this is our t here. Okay. Then this is equal to what? E to the negative lambda times, this is e to the lambda times e to the t. Make sense?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, good. Thank you. And then we can simplify a little bit. Okay, lambda is a common factor, so we can factor out lambda and then e to the t minus 1. Okay, do you agree? This is a m of t. The moment generating function looks like this, e to the lambda times e to the t minus 1. Okay, this is a moment generating function. So once we have moment generating function, we can differentiate one time and two times and then plug in zero. And we can get the moment, the first moment and second moment. And then use those guys to get the mean and then variance. Okay. So we need the derivative. Okay, derivative. M prime of t. What is this guy? M prime of t. Differentiate. This is a e to the lambda times e to the t minus 1 itself, first of all, and times the derivative of this part. First derivative. I'm using a chain rule, of course. This derivative is a lambda times e to the t. Right? Is that right? So you can tell mean mu. Mean mu is n prime plugged in zero. In zero. This is zero. T is zero. Then this is one. Okay. E to the zero is one. One minus one is zero. And then this part is one. This is also one. So lambda is the only thing remaining. So this is lambda. Okay. Lambda is your mean mu. One more time, we need to differentiate. One more time, derivative of this. So you can use product rule, whatever you like, product rule. Then a derivative of this times this, derivative of this times this, plus this times this derivative. The derivative of this is this. That means that this times this square, do you agree?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, good, thank you. times this will be the derivative of this. I need to multiply by this, so this is square. Okay, square. That's the first part. I differentiated this, and then times lambda e to the t. So lambda times e to the t, there's one more, so square. And plus, okay, this itself, e to the t minus one, and times the this derivative. What is this derivative? This itself, lambda times e to the t. Okay, lambda times e to the t itself, right? So this is the one. Okay, we plug in zero, okay, zero for t. Okay, so double phi naught zero. What is this guy? One more time, okay, this is one, so one minus one is zero, so this part is one. And then this is square, so e to the zero is one. So lambda squared is here. Okay, lambda squared is here. And what is this? Yeah, same as this guy. So that is just lambda. Okay, lambda. This is a one. Lambda squared plus lambda. One more step. So sigma squared is m double second derivative of zero minus m prime of zero square. Okay, that is a lambda square plus lambda minus lambda square. Oh, lambda square, they're gone, and then lambda. Good. Okay. So m is mu. Okay, this is one, and then sigma square is also lambda. Very weird distribution. Mean and variance are the same all the time. We have only one parameter, lambda, and then lambda represents the mean and the variance. Okay, that's what this is. All right, then I shall do, oh, by the way, Poisson distribution has a table for, I should mention, okay, a table for Poisson distribution. Table for Poisson distribution that is given. X is subject to Poisson of lambda, then a probability that X is more than or equal to X. Okay, this is given. Okay, this is given.
It's on page.
Four ninety eight to five hundred. The distribution state is given. It is given by lambda. Okay, for lambda. That is equal to 0.1, 0.2, and so on. And so on. 2.0. And after that, it is given 2.2, 2.4, yeah. And then 4, 6 like 6.0 0.2 0.2 oh I'm sorry. Okay, table is given for the Poisson distribution. And then lambda is equal to 0.1, starting 0.1, 0.2, and so on. And up to 2.0, 0.1, okay, 0.1. After that, 0.2, up to 6.0. And after that, I think 6.5, 7.0, and so on. Okay. The left, okay, it's going to be left, but it's okay. Anyway, so this is given. So we can use this table, right? Otherwise, we have to calculate the exponential, okay, exponential, e to the something. Yeah, you need a calculator, otherwise we can't. So you can use a Poisson distribution table and get some values. Okay, so I'll do two examples. I'll show two examples. 2.72 and 2.74. I'll show you. Assuming x is subject to the Poisson. And then parameter is 3. And we like to find the probability that. No, not A. Just one question, sorry. Probability that x is equal to 2. Yeah, 2. One way is use the probability mass function. That's possible. Okay. Lambda is equal to 2. So, how do you do this? Lambda is equal to 3, so 3 to the x is equal to 2, 3 squared times e to the negative 3, right? And then divided by x is equal to 2, so 2 factorial. Okay, this is one way. Okay, this is one way. Use a probability mass function and then use a calculator, then you can do. Other way is use the table. How do you use the table? Table is giving you this probability, okay, less than or equal to x. And this is probability that x is more than or equal to 2, okay, minus probability that x is equal to, or less than or equal to 1. Okay. We have to notice this. This portion gives you the probability that x is equal to 2. Less than or equal to 2 minus the less than or equal to 1. And then these two guys are given in the table. So you can use this. And if you do so, then this will be given by. I'm using the table, right? And then it is giving you a three-digit number. So 0.423. Minus 0.199. So get the three digit number and then 0.224. Probably if you calculate by this, then you have the same number like this. Hope so. Using the table, we can do without any calculation, just a subtraction. Okay, that's all. Okay, subtraction, you can do without calculator, right? So this is a way. Okay, this is one example. Okay, then our next example. We have time. Okay, we have 15 minutes, but I shall finish a little bit early. 274, one more example. In this case, Poisson distribution is given. X is subject to Poisson, but we don't know the parameter. Poisson distribution lambda, okay? This is not given, but some other conditions are given, such that the three times of probability that x is equal to 1 is equal to is probability that x is equal to 2. Okay, so these are given. Then we need to figure out this, not this, but under these conditions, what is the probability that x is equal to 4, x is equal to 4. Okay, this is what? Okay, this is a question. Very interesting. X is up subject to the Poisson distribution, and then we have a condition, three times of the probability that x is equal to 1 is is equal to the probability that x is equal to 2. Then what is the probability of x is equal to 4? This is a question. Okay. Then how do you proceed? Then can you write this amount and also this amount using lambda? Probability that x is equal to 1 or x is equal to 2 using lambda, can you write? Yeah, of course. So write it down using the formula, something like this. Something like this. So three times of this, this is a lambda is not known. So lambda to x is equal to 1, n times e to the negative lambda, right? And then divided by 1 factorial, 1 is x is equal to 1. This is the left-hand side, okay? And then that is equal to the right side. Right side is a lambda squared, and then e to the negative lambda, always, and divided by 2 factorial, right? So this is given, obtained. And can you simplify and solve for lambda? Can we simplify and solve for lambda? Yeah, of course you can do it, right? Well, first of all, e to the negative lambda, e to the negative lambda. We can cancel these guys, okay? And one lambda is cancelled, okay? This is cancelled, and this two is just become one. This is remaining. And a constant, three, this is two. Yeah, so what do you have? Three is equal to lambda over two, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, so lambda is six. Okay, wow. We get lambda, lambda is equal to six. This is what we get. Then it's easy to get the probability, okay? This guy. There are two ways. One way is using the table. Other ways are just using the form of the probability mass function. Well, let's use a table, that's easier. Okay. So probability x is equal to 4 is, once again, we need a subtraction. Okay, this is given by x is smaller than or equal to 4 minus what? X is smaller than or equal to 3. Okay, this is the idea. Look up the table and then get the value. Get the value. This is equal to 0.629. Minus 0.433. So subtraction, this is 0.196, probably. Okay, so this is done. Now we don't have to have the exact value. If you like to have the exact value, then we have to leave E, exponential E. But we're not so interested in that form. So three-digit number is enough. Three-digit number is enough. Well, maybe I should show you the result on the table. So, yeah, okay. Yeah, we have the table, right? Okay, this is page 499. Maybe you can see 499. lambda is equal to 6. These are the values of lambda, and the 6 is over here. Lambda is 6. And then we're talking about x is equal to 4. So x is equal to 4 is right here. So 4 is here, right? This is what? 285. Am I wrong? Yeah, looks like I am wrong. What happened? Where did I look at 692? Yeah, I'm sorry, this is wrong. It is wrong. So I should look up this guy. Lambda is equal to 6. Yeah, okay. My mistake. I'm sorry. So I look up lambda is equal to 6, first of all, and then x is equal to 4. X is equal to 4 is this, 0.285 minus x is equal to 3, so minus 0.151. Okay. This minus this, that's the answer. I'm sorry. So I should rewrite this guy. This is wrong. Okay. So now is equal to 0.285 minus 0.151. Okay. So should be what? 0.134, all right? And this is the answer. I'm sorry, made a mistake. That's how we use the table. Okay, this is the answer. Right. One more thing I'd like to mention. Okay. We derived the Poisson distribution of probability mass function. Then we noticed that there's a resemblance between the binomial distribution. Okay. So here's the one we did. Okay. This is a one. This is the one. Then this looks like a binomial distribution. This is a P. And then this is 1 minus P. This is N choose X. N choose X times probability P. P to the X and then times 1 minus P to the power N minus X. Looks like a binomial distribution. That means we can approximate the binomial distribution by Poisson, because the binomial distribution approximated the Poisson distribution. So we can do the backward. We can do backward. So let me mention that one. That is a. I shall do in detail next time. Okay. What I'm saying is a Poisson. Okay. Poisson distribution lambda, and then binomial of n, and then p, okay? And these are very close. The relation between lambda and p is given by n times p is equal to lambda, lambda. And this is the p. Poisson distribution and a binomial distribution, they are very close and it's kind of large enough. Large means more than 20, then we can say the resemblance. Okay. So for instance, n is greater than 20. and NP is smaller than 0.05. Okay, in this case, while N is greater than 100, and NP is smaller than or equal to 0.10. But thirdly, we can say N is equal to say 50, and then P is equal to 0.12. Okay. I don't know why this is coming, but this is kind of the example. Okay, example. When N and P are satisfying these things, then we can approximate to distributions. And binomial distribution is very hard to derive. As you know, N is larger than a combination is very big. Number of combination is very big. So it's very hard to derive the each value. But if you use the Poisson distribution, then it becomes simpler. Okay. That's how it works. Okay, I shall do this part a little bit more in detail. Okay. The next time. Do you have any question? Do you have a question on the homework? I have time, so you can ask me. If not, then you can ask me next time. Okay. And also, if you have questions on midterm exam, the private tree, you can ask me. You can email me, and I'm going to answer. All right, class is over, dismissed. So if you have questions on homework, then you can stay and ask me. So have a nice day.